we say brother and sister round here. It's because we're a family and these folks are so near. When one has a heartache, we all share the tears and rejoice in each victory in this family so dear.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
I've been washed in the fountain,
cleansed by His blood. Joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family, the family of God.
From the door of an orphanage to the house of the King, no longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags unto riches, from the weak to the strong, I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God I belong.
Oh, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
I've been washed in the fountain,
cleansed by His blood. Joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this side.
For I'm part of
the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God.
I've been washed in the fountain,
cleansed by His blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this side.
For I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad.
Because of our sinfulness, we are not worthy, but praise God, through the blood of Jesus Christ, we belong. Yes, we belong. We are so glad that we are a part of the family of God. Good evening to the family of God. Welcome to our Family Life Week program. Our focus will be on emotional wellness. We're looking at mental wellness, I should say. And throughout the course of this week, we will be looking at different aspects of mental wellness. This evening, we'll be looking at mental and emotional wellness. Come Tuesday evening, by the grace of God, we'll be looking at social and intellectual wellness. And again, by His help, Wednesday evening, we will be looking at spiritual wellness. So under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, we have a list of programs, wonderful program ideas lined up that the family of God can benefit from. And of course, like every other family here on this earth, we are not exempted from the challenges that sin and sinfulness goes throwing around. So of course, we have to ensure that we put things in place, put activities in place to help strengthen each other as we go along on this pathway. Like I said before, this evening we'll be looking at emotional and mental wellness. But I just want to share a little quote with you from the pen of inspiration, coming to us from Councils on Health, under the topic Develop Ability. The servant of the Lord says, none should consent to be mere machines run by another man's mind, because we were never made like that by our Creator. We were made with options, with the freedom of choice. We weren't made like robots, yes? Because God wants us to express our love willingly and freely unto Him, and as such also unto our fellow men. So we should never at any time consent to be operated or be run like mere machines. God has given us ability to think and to act. And it is by acting with carefulness, looking to Him, God, our Creator and our Sustainer for wisdom, that you and I will become capable of bearing burdens. Now we are admonished, stand in your God-given responsibility. Yes, stand in your God-given responsibility. Be no other person's shadow. And I love this sentence. Be no other person's shadow. So never at any time should we seek to live our lives according to how we see someone else live. No matter how good or how comfortable or how happy the life of someone else may seem in our eyes, always remember that you are unique. There's only one of you in this entire world. There's no one else that's exactly like you. And each time that we seek to live in the shadow of somebody else, seek to copy how someone else lives, we are robbing the world of experiencing the true us. And God has created all of us to experience the true of each other. We are to expect that the Lord will work in and by and through you and me. Sister Garshell will now take us through Singspiration.
Yeah. just to be where you are. Across the hottest desert, I'll travel near or far. Just to see, to behold you as
my King.
For your glory,
I will do it.
Just to see,
to behold you as
And our next song will be Praise Is What I Do.
Praise is what I do. When I want to be close to you, I lift my hands in praise. Praise is who I will praise him while I can. I'll bless him yet.
And now we'll have our final song, which is a favorite of many. It's called You Are Alpha and Omega. Feel free to sing along.
We give you
We give you, Lord, all the glory because you are worthy, 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 worthy to be praised. This evening, thank you, Sister Garshel. Thank you so much for those worship songs. Thank you. This evening, we have in our virtual worship service visiting friends, and we are never out of visitors in this worship session. On a given Sunday evening, we have visiting friends from Canada, from the USA, and right here in Jamaica. I will not get into the calling of names. By so doing, I will not put myself in any trouble. Just want to say to all of our visiting worshipers, we welcome you. We welcome you because guess what? There is plenty, plenty in Jamaica, we'd say enough. There is plenty of room in the family. And Brother Alex will take us through our theme song, Plenty of Room in the Family. So make yourselves welcome and feel at home. Plenty of room in the family.
Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love. Plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold.
Plenty of food on the table, no need to economize there. You know there's all you can hold, and more besides, and the storehouse will never be bare.
Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love. Plenty of room in the fold.
Well, if you're lonely and looking for friendship, and you're lost but you wanna be found, well, there's plenty of room in the family of God, and plenty of love to go round.
Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love. Plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of room in the family. Room for the young and the old. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold. Plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold.
Our special family life edition this evening continues with the theme being mental and emotional wellness, and the focus is on the youth of our family. And so far, we would have had persons from the youthful aspect of our family doing their part. Sister Garshel took us through Singspiration, and as the program progresses, we will hear from more of our youth. We'll now have our opening hymn, My Faith Looks Up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary, 517. Feel free to sing along in praise. We continue, my faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day be holy thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire. As thou hast died for me, oh, may my love to thee pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. While life's dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Be darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's tears away, nor let me ever stray from thee aside. Praise his name. We have a God who we can look up to. He is the head of our family, our church family, and because he is a sure help, he's always there. He's never an absentee parent, he's always on duty, so we can always look to him at all times. Our passage of meditation comes to us from Philippians 2 verse 5 to 10, and another youth of our congregation, this time is Sister Peyton Miller, will bring to us the scripture reading.
The
scripture reading is taken from to Philippians 2, verse 5 to 10. I will read in your hearing. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth.
Amen.
Amen.
Brother Brian Earl Cymrie will now take us to the throne of grace in prayer. Go ahead and pray for us, Brian. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful family life ministry night. Thank you, Lord, for carrying everybody here to worship with us. Thank you, Lord, for grace and mercy upon us. Thank you, Lord, for protecting us from the evil spirits. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us. Thank you, Lord, for everything. Thank you, Lord, for putting food on our table. Thank you, Lord, for putting shelter over our heads. Thank you, Lord, for making us wear clothes on our body. Thank you, Lord, for everything you have done for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brian Earl, for interceding on our behalf. It's greatly appreciated. And yes, the host of heaven has taken record of the contribution of our children and our youth to the advancing of his kingdom. Peyton read quite well for us, and Brian did pray quite well on our behalf. We have a special presenter in our mix this evening, but the task is not mine to introduce him. There is someone else who is better able to do it than I can. So I'll allow Sister Helen Tomlinson to introduce our guest presenter. Go ahead, Sister Helen.
Amen. The pleasure of mine is to introduce the speaker for tonight. The speaker for tonight, Pastor Desmond C. Hay. He's an experienced teacher, preacher, and lecturer on issues relating to faith and spirituality. He holds academic degrees from Northern Caribbean University and Andrews University in theology and counseling. Pastor Hay holds a postgraduate certificate in nutrition, health, and lifestyle from Vanderbilt University. Pastor Hay has served the church in the capacity of pastor, teacher, and health educator. Currently, he serves as founder and speaker of the 7-7 prayer ministry that meets 7 a.m., 7 p.m., 7 days per week, online for worship and prayer. He is a board certified chaplain through the Association of Pastoral Counselors. Pastor Hay is a certified post-traumatic stress disorder specialist with a wealth of experience in dealing with trauma, mental health, and psychosocial issues. He is currently engaged in postgraduate work in the School of Public Health at the State University of New York, Albany. Pastor Hay is married to the love of his life, Stacian Hay Neelinton. The union has produced one son, Caleb. Stacian is a licensed social worker in the state of New York. Pastor Hay is a lover of people and a friend of God. His philosophy, the mind controlled by Christ is the measure of the man, has characterized his ministry service. After the song of meditation, the next voice you hear is of Pastor Desmond C. Hay. Hear he him. Amen.
All right, good evening, everybody. And we bring you greetings from the east to the west. And we are very happy to be sharing in Sunday evening family life programming. As you know, family life has been very dear to me. And, you know, it gives me pleasure to be a part of this celebration of families. Tonight, Janet will be singing for you. It's an African song. It's not a family song per se. It's a praise song. And part of good mental health is praising God. It's very essential to mental health. So I trust as she sings tonight that your hearts will be blessed and your souls will be watered and the way would have been prepared for my very good friend, who I haven't seen in a very long time, Pastor Desmond Hay. So happy to have glimpsed him earlier on. And, you know, it's a big shout out to all the Bart family, you know, why COVID-19 has kept us apart for so long, you know. But in due time, all things in God's timing. So I'm going to have Janelle. She'll tell you what the African, the English interpretation of the song is, and she'll sing it for you. God bless you.
Good night, everyone. So, as my father said, the song is called Imela, and the chorus says, Imela, Imela, Okaka Onye Kerua, Imela, Imela, Ezemo. That means thank you, great creator of the world. Thank you, my king. Thank you.
Eternal God, rescue the words that shall be spoken from these lips. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, O Rock and O Redeemer. And all of God's people say, amen and amen. I greet you with Jesus' joy, and it is the privilege and joy are mine to really be with you tonight for this worship experience, your family life experience. And I want to thank my dear sister Helen Tomlinson Henry for her kind words of introduction. And anything that happens tonight, blame it on Dahlia. Dahlia is the cause of all of this. And she has a partner in crime by the name of Helen. And they're working well with a Prendergast down there. But we give God thanks. It's good to see you all. It has been years, years. I've seen so many of you together in one setting. But I am delighted nonetheless to be asked to share in tonight's family life experience. And I want you to know that Petersfield is my home. Petersfield District is my home. And Bath, back in the day, was the stomping grounds. And Elder Wallace can tell you of the exploits that we did together. Nonetheless, I'm delighted to see you all. And I want you to know that we are together again to praise the Lord. I am excited about the possibilities and what you are focusing on, such a very pertinent subject matter of mental illness. It's something that churches don't really talk about these days, but I'm so happy to see that my church, my district, if you please, you're championing the cause of mental illness. And I want to share with you for the next few minutes some preliminary thoughts. They are not by any means a complete package. I have 30 minutes in which to share with you an entire book, but I will use the time wisely and share as we look at our young people, as we look at mental illness, mind control, mental illness among families in the church. And I want you to realize that in these times, our young people are affected by this very grave issue. And we shall see that it is a crisis happening around us. And I want you to know tonight that mental illness is something that affects all of us. We are all impacted by it. It is real. It is not a taboo. It is something that we need to talk about. It is something of utmost importance in the church. And tonight we are going to lay the foundation for a working definition of what mental health looks like. And then we will look at what mental illness looks like. And we will talk about some things that's happening around us. So let's dive right in into tonight's presentation. Now, I want to ask you a question. And as you think about the question, I will play this video. And I want to ask you a question. Listen to me. Have you in the last year come across anyone who has been challenged mentally, who has been struggling with mental illness? And I want two individuals to share, what's your first impression of that individual or individuals for that matter, when it comes on to this? Be honest. What's your impression? What comes to your mind first when you think about mental illness? But I want you to pause as you're thinking about that to just view. Amen. Amen. I hope that brought into perspective the subject matter at hand. I want someone, you're out there this evening, to share it in that question that was asked earlier. Have you ever in the last year come across someone that's mentally challenged or is struggling with mental illness? And what was your initial impression? What hit you first? What came to you first? Off the bat, anyone, you can unmute and you can share. I want two individuals to share. Anyone out there?
Good evening, everyone. When I first thought about, I have met someone with a mental illness, and I wasn't looking at it as that this person is going crazy. I was just thinking, what can I do to support this person? What are the possible avenues I could find to assist this person? Because the challenge that I have seen, it's not like this person is going off. The person was just depressed. And depression is a serious mental illness.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing. So you were in the mode of trying to help, to see how you can be a support and presence. Powerful. Anyone else wants to share tonight? The second and final person, have you come in contact with someone who's struggling with mental illness over the last year? What was the first impression that came to your mind?
Good evening. Over the past year, I've seen a lot of mental illnesses in different forms, and especially nowadays with the COVID happening. You know, a lot of people are stressed and depressed. And so when I do see them, the first thing I think is possibly how can I help them? And I also think of the fact that there I go, but for the grace of God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to realize that mental health is central to everyone's well-being, particularly our adolescents, if you please, or teens or young adults. or youth, they are active in community, they're engaged in the church, and sometimes we feel that, oh, they don't have a problem in the world. I want to debunk that stigma tonight and to help you to realize that they are facing grave challenges. And I want you to realize that there are many cases when they are depressed and they're dealing with the challenges of life. Now, I want to give a working definition or at least go through a few pointers as it regards mental health. Mental health defined really is the absence of mental disease. So you are in a healthy state of mind. There is nothing really to cause a serious breakdown, or it has not reached the point of crisis where you become helpless or you're in a state of helplessness. But it's a state of being that also includes really the biological, the psychological or social factors which contribute to an individual's mental state and the ability to function within the environment. I can tell you that in my experience, I have seen, I remember just the other day, I was heading to a particular visit and I saw this young lady standing by the roadside, and I noticed that she was muttering underneath her breath, so to speak, and I realized that something was happening. And as I pulled up and as I parked, I realized that she was at the point of breaking. And for us who are trained, you're able to pick up on certain things, the body language, the behavior. And she just started to strip right in the street. And I was in my car, I was parking, and I realized that here was someone who had a meltdown, and it was so horrible. We had to intervene and get help for her, but it's real, it's real. Young people are challenged with it, old are challenged with it. Individuals outside of the church, they struggle with it. Individuals within the church, they're struggling with mental health, is mental illness. Now, mental health really is that state of mental health. It really implies that the individual has the ability to really form and maintain affectionate relationships with others. Don't you ever take for granted that this that we are experiencing tonight, the ability to see and to engage and to be in community, don't ever take it lightly. Ladies and gentlemen, there are individuals who do not possess the requisite mental capacity or ability to engage as we are. They have lost that ability because of diseases of various kinds and because of problems that they're facing. So when one is mentally well, they are able to really maintain those affectionate relationships with others and the ability really to perform their social roles. They're able to develop healthy relationships, they're able to communicate, they're able to have interpersonal skills and intrapersonal relationships and skills. And we realize that they get to play a part in society and they get to manage their lives and to do the work that they've been called to do very well. Now, one of the things I want you to realize this evening is that with, as someone mentioned earlier, with the incidence of COVID-19, we are in a new ball game. I have said this from the outset. The problem will not be COVID-19. The problem will be the psychological and mental breakdown as a result of this pandemic. Yes, thousands are dying. Yea, millions will die as a result. But ladies and gentlemen, if you sit where I sit, if you see what I see every day, you will realize that our world is on the verge of a stupendous crisis. We can't deal with it. We can't contain it because psychologically, young are losing it. Old are losing it. I've seen doctors who are serving in healthcare facilities melt down. I've seen nurses, I've seen healthcare professionals just overwhelmed and have a serious mental breakdown. Now, it's a crisis. It's a very difficult time and our youth aren't exempt. They are now sheltering in place. many of whom are going back to school, and it is a new normal, and things are truly different, and they are wondering, many of them, how am I going to engage? How am I going to have healthy relationships if I have to social distance, and life is just going to be a tough road from here? But I want to continue to bring to your attention of this evening what I have here on the screen, which we call in the mental and psychosocial circles the trans domain model of health. And you see here three circles that are intersecting. And I want you to realize that when we are able to function in good mental health, we're talking about the standard level of cognitive, emotional functioning and adaptation. You're able to adjust to the movement. So COVID-19 has come, things are out of whack, you're not working, you lost your job, you don't just melt down and die. You are able to adjust, you are able to make wise decisions, you are able to make cognitive decisions that will really impact your sense of coherence, your subjective sense of understanding and managing your stresses, so you're able to mentally deal with what is coming your way. You have a great sense of autonomy, which is your capacity, your locus of control, if you please, where you are able to have control over yourself. You have not reached that place where you are unable to maintain the mental equilibrium where you and I really and truly we can focus, we can articulate our needs, we have control. Some individuals, they're losing control. They're becoming more abusive. We are looking at the literature now and the stats, and we are seeing that individuals who have been sheltering in place for the last how many months? 9-10 months now, from March until now, ladies and gentlemen, marriages are under attack, because all these years you have been living with your partner, but you really didn't love him, and now you must be in the same place for this protracted period. Can you imagine the real mental stress and anguish that people are going under, and they're losing that autonomy, that locus of control? The sense of us, when you're mentally well, and when you're mentally healthy, you have the capacity for relating to and with others. We are able to talk. We are able to engage in meaningful conversations. We are able to share and to bear one another's burdens. We are able to have that sense of us. It's a sense of community. It's a sense of what we call in the Greek, the koinonia, the fellowship, the togetherness, which in the context of COVID-19 has been impacted, because when you could meet together in your church circles, you are no longer able to do so. But we are finding that technology is bringing us together. But as technology brings us together, ladies and gentlemen, we're finding that we are becoming Zoom fatigue, which is another problem. So it's a plethora of issues. But when one is mentally healthy, there is a standard level of cognitive and emotional functioning. There is autonomy. There is a sense of us. There is what we call agency. Now, agency is the ability to really choose one's level of social participation. You can either accept, you can reject, you can change social, legal, and theological practices. You are able to be your own person and to choose wisely and to make rational decisions as it regards your life, your well-being, and your ability to just live in the environment. You're also socially well. So when your mental health takes the social aspect, the social sphere, where at that standard level of interpersonal functioning and adaptation, there is interdependence, you know, mutual reliance on and responsibility to others within society. So no man is an island. No man stands alone. Each man or woman, for that matter, is my brother, my sister, as the case may be. So we are socially well. We are healthy. We have control, the capacity to really navigate social spaces. You have control over yourself. You are able to do and to be and to exist and to enjoy life in its fullness. It also involves the physical sphere, where your standard of level of really balance, you're really that homeostatic maintenance where you're balanced, you are able to take care of your physical being, you're able to really do well physically, you're in good health, you're not sick, you're not always coming down with the flu, you know, things like that. So we're looking here at this model of the trans-domain model of health. And when we are functioning in all spheres, according to the literature, we are said to be mentally well. So you can look tonight, where are you lacking? How are you doing? How are you coping? Now, it's the ability really we talked about to recognize and to acknowledge and to communicate. And please understand, ladies and gentlemen, that mental health does not exist on its own. Mental health also involves the feeling of positivity. You feel good. The guy says, I feel good about myself. You stand before the mirror. You look good. You're doing well. You're able to balance life. And there is a sense of positivity. Ladies, when you look at yourself, young people, when you see yourself, you feel good about yourself. You're a child of the King. You walk upright. You feel well. And you also feel glad and joyful about others. And you are also loving. I want you to realize that mental illness on the other end of the spectrum is really a condition that affects the person's thinking, feeling, their behavior, or mood. And these conditions, if you please, they affect every aspect of your daily life, your day-to-day living. It also affects your ability to relate to others. You become very antsy. You are just edgy. You can't really function. And a mental health condition isn't the result of one event. It's very important that you realize that, ladies and gentlemen. It's a plethora. And the research suggests there are multiple linking causes. There are genetics, there are environmental lifestyle issues, whether someone develops a mental health condition or not. I want you to also realize this evening, I want you to realize that this issue of mental health and mental illness, it's affecting people all over the world. Listen to me. There is what you call the internal factors, a lack of emotional resilience. There is no more courage to go on. You are under the cloud and you don't feel like even going out of bed. You are depressed, which is a mental health condition. As some individuals become schizoid personality, you name it. There are different aspects to it. There is poor self-esteem and social status. You feel trapped and you feel helpless. And there are problems even associated with sexuality or sexual orientation. People are questioning their ability. There is also isolation and poor integration. You just don't feel like you fit in with everybody else. And external factors also impact the mental well-being and can contribute to mental illness, or what we call in the literature, mental demotion. This vulnerability, poor social conditions. If you're living in a setting where you do not have the basic necessities of life, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you're able to take care of food and clothing and shelter. You know, poor social conditions can affect one's mental health and can contribute to a mental illness or a mental demotion, if you please. Discrimination or abuse, cultural conflict, stigma, which is something I want to talk about, especially as we look in the Jamaican context, and poor autonomy, among other factors, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I want you to understand the stats. One in four families in the world have a family member who struggles with mental illness. Think about that. One in every four of you on this conference, in this worship tonight, you have a family member or a close relative, somebody near to you who struggles with mental illness. Yes, it might be taboo. They might not talk about it, especially in the Jamaican context. When I was growing up, they say, mad, sick, head no good. Yes, and they would lock up your grandfather in the house and they would take him out. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Put it in the chat out there. They would take him out and they would put him in the sun. And they said they'd give him a sun bath. A sunbathing, if you please, because grandfather was struggling with mental health issues, but the family was not able, especially in the Jamaican context where this is taboo, you know, or people, we don't want to talk about it. Who, mad? No, nobody in my family mad. We all healthy and we all doing good and no madman, not mad people, not in my family. And so we are afraid to talk about and to acknowledge it. Ladies and gentlemen, one in four families in the world, this is not just America, in the world, have a family member who struggles with mental illness. I have seen it in my own family. I have seen it in so many other families. I have seen it as I have pastored, when I pastored congregations. I have seen it in practice. I have seen it in hospital settings, in clinical settings. I have seen it in so many different locations, ladies and gentlemen. Mental illness is real. 450 million people suffer with mental illness worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the population of many countries combined, including Jamaica. We are just, what, 3 million people there? Ladies and gentlemen, 450 million. See how many times 3 million can go into that. And ladies and gentlemen, these are sufferers, these many of whom are silent sufferers, many of whom are members who come to our churches. They sit on the pews. They sing with us, even in the praise team. They are a part of the various groups and they are struggling with a mental illness. 16% of jail inmates have a mental illness. 26% of the homeless have a mental illness. You see them by the roadside. They are struggling. Many of them were doctors and teachers and lawyers, but the vicissitudes of life, the difficulties, the challenges of life reach them at a really, hit them at a really soft and delicate spot. And now they have lost that locus of control and they aren't able to do the things and to have that trans domain, that balance, that equilibrium, that homeostasis that you and I, we celebrate tonight. We are in our right minds, but you want to walk into a psychiatric ward and you want to see 16-year-olds. You want to see 26-year-olds. You want to see 40-year-olds. You want to see individuals, brilliant, who were on the honor roll in med school and law school, and with a mental breakdown. None of us are immune, ladies and gentlemen. We are all in this together. And I want you to understand tonight that one, listen, I'm coming home, one out of four Jamaicans are afraid to discuss mental illness because we have been acculturated, we have been socialized to believe that this is a taboo. Don't talk about it. Mad, sick, head, no good. Don't talk about it. We are not going to speak about it. We're afraid to discuss it. And this happens now when you cross cultures and you come into another context, especially in North America. You will find individuals from the Caribbean, Jamaican, things are happening and they will become closed to seeking help. Because if I reach out, it is saying that something is wrong with my family and we don't have it all together. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope in tonight's presentation that we will be able to break down some of those barriers and to destigmatize, if you please, and to just talk about it. 35% of our youth in this meeting are struggling with some form of mental related issues that will go undiagnosed. Now I want you to realize, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to come to the realization that we're talking about the Jamaican context. We're talking based on what the World Health Organization is saying, that one out of four Jamaicans are afraid to discuss mental health, mental illness, and 35% of our young people, they are there in church and they have a mental condition. They're struggling with something that will go undiagnosed. 30 to 40% of individuals are told that their condition is not mental illness. This is where I need to talk to the church tonight, but it's demon possession. And we need to cast that demon out in the name of Jesus. And it's a spiritual issue. It's not mental issue. The devil take you over. The devil take over your mind. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand, be it far from it. Yes, I must admit, I have seen it. There are many instances, there are many cases where there is clear demon possession. I think that it does exist. It is real. I have confronted demonic elements in my ministry and in my work. It is real. But there is a percentage, a cross section of our church that says, listen, it is not mental health problems that you're having. It's not mental illness you're having. You are demon possessed, and we become the DSM-5, and we diagnose, and we tell people what they are doing and what's happening with them. And as a result, we sweep the problem under the rug. 40% of Jamaicans say they will not talk about mental illness. When was the last time someone spoke to you about a struggle that they're going through, a mental struggle? Think about it. It's very rare in our culture because there is this fear and there is this stigma. Now, let me just run down with you briefly here some warning signs. Now, diagnosing mental illness isn't a straightforward science, as you might realize. We can test for it the same way. We really can't test for it the same way we test blood sugar levels for diabetes or your blood pressure. Each condition has its own unique symptoms. And those some symptoms, ladies and gentlemen, often overlap. Common signs and symptoms can really include, number one, a feeling of sadness. You're very sad or withdrawn for more than 2 weeks. You find yourself in your little shell by yourself. You don't want to talk to anybody. Young people, I'm speaking to you out there. You're on your phone. You're in your world by yourself for over 2 weeks. You're trying to harm yourself or to end your life, or you're making plans to do so. There is suicidal ideation. There is the planning of the suicide act. And these are things that we look for if the individual is about to be of harm to himself or herself or harm to others. There is a severe out of control risk-taking behavior. You know, there's an upswing. You just start drinking or smoking or engaging in illicit sex, or you are now using the needle, or you know, that will bring harm to yourself and others. There is also the sudden overwhelming fear for no reason. You're just afraid. You're just petrified and terrified, and sometimes with a racing heartbeat, you're just anxiety and panic attack just take over. There's physical discomfort or even difficulty breathing. There is significant weight loss or significant weight gain, where an individual might be eating more because they are stressed. or an individual might be going through a mental episode, a breakdown, and they just don't eat. They become very bulimic, and they will vomit often, and they will do all kinds of activities that are just outside of the norm. We see here that seeing or hearing or believing things that aren't real. Ladies and gentlemen, you know, I want you to know that so many individuals struggle with this excessive, they're hearing, oh, pastor, I'm hearing, and, you know, he's telling me to do this and to do that. And I want you to understand that there is excessive use of alcohol or drugs, drastic changes in mood, behavior, personality, or sleeping habits, just to name a few, ladies and gentlemen. I want you to realize this evening that mental health care matters, ladies and gentlemen. Mental health care matters. Adults, the average delay between symptoms onset and treatment is 11 years. So people are sitting there longer and longer with the condition, and they are not seeking help. And people who get treatment in a given year, 43% of adults with mental illness really seek treatment, and 64% of adults with serious mental health. So these are individuals who wait until it is far gone. Ladies and gentlemen, many of whom have to be medicated. You know, 51% of youth 6 through 17 with a mental health condition. It is a crisis that's happening. And I want you to understand that it doesn't only affect you, young people. When you are dealing with these situations, the people with these serious mental health illnesses, they have an increased risk for chronic diseases like diabetes, heart attack, cancer, because what? Your immune system is now impacted, and you will become weaker and sicker. And not only that, it also affects your family, because the research is showing that at least 8.4 million Americans, and I want you to know thousands of Jamaicans, also provide care for adults with an emotional or mental health problem. Caregivers, they spend an average of 32 hours per week providing unpaid care for someone that's impacted. So there's a ripple effect. It goes from the person to the family to the community. 37% of people incarcerated in prisons, ladies and gentlemen, have a diagnosed mental condition. Depression is the leading cause of disability worldwide. And I want you to know tonight, we can address the problem. We can deal with it. I want you to watch this video real quickly. My time has gone, and I won't be able to complete the presentation, but I just want to awaken your minds to this very important subject and the need for us to address it, especially in the Jamaican context. After the video, we're going to talk about stigma. Watch. Thank you. You got the message of the video. I hope everyone is able to see clearly. Now, the only point I will be able to make in this segment and in this section, in the interest of time, my 30 minutes on my clock is gone. I want to address one big point tonight. And I want to speak to my church. I want to speak to my people. I want to speak to you from the inner recesses of my heart. We must break the stigma. I repeat, we must break the stigma. Stigmatization will only act as a barrier to seeking care and really adhering to treatment recommendations. It also leads to lower self-esteem and reduced social opportunities. Members of the church, members in the Jamaican context, the stigma surrounding mental illness must be broken. The church, I believe, in my estimation, I believe that the church is the great answer. If you ask me, I believe the church is the great answer to the mental health, mental illness challenges we are facing. Because I can tell you from the literature, people are quicker or will easily come to a pastor to seek help than they will go to a physician or a clinician. And I want you to realize that we are positioned, but if the church is not socialized, acculturated, understand the need to break the stigma, we find ourselves in a position where it's a hush-hush and we are not talking about it. And it only leads to lower self-esteem, reduced social opportunities. Now, stigmatization render individuals with mental illness as non-entities. And we do it in the Jamaican context. Oh, he's mad. Leave him alone. Leave him out of everything. Boy, mad. And in turn, worthless. And he's not good for nothing. And the church sits on the sidewalk, if you please. The church sits in the grandstand as individuals are being labeled. And they are being categorized, they are being isolated, and the stigma is perpetuated. We are positioned as a church to deal with the stigma associated with mental illness. Now, in the eyes of many community members, ladies and gentlemen, basically individuals who are mentally ill, non-entities. And you rob them really of any power to control the circumstances in which they live. So they become powerless, they are non-entities, there is no hope for them. And when that happens, people die. People jump from buildings. People take pills. People do stuff that they would not otherwise do. And our young people at an alarming rate now, because they have become so insular, they are not internal, they don't have, for the most part, any social relationships, and so they are within themselves. Can you imagine when the vicissitudes, the challenges, the difficulties of life come slamming in? There is nowhere to turn, because if I go to the elder of the church, he's gonna say, boy, hush up. When you talk about you having emotional or psychological concerns. And so it's a hush hush. And you know, my Jamaican friends out there, you know, my people, you know that this is a fact. And the research is clear. Stigma may even negatively affect the course and the prognosis of the mental illness itself. Because of the stigma, we don't talk about it. It's a hush hush. We are not gonna name it. Are you getting it? We're not going to name it that uncle has so-and-so and dada has so-and-so and my mother is struggling with this depression thing. We are not naming it. So what's going to happen? It will not be properly diagnosed. And if it's not properly diagnosed, ladies and gentlemen, there will not be proper interventions. There will not be treatment for individuals who might need it. And there is no way out, and it becomes a dark room. And people die. The church must view mental health holistically. Stop telling people that all suffering is the result of sin. I know you're going to touch me. We're going to go down the theological platform, because that's what we tell people all the time. The suffering of mental anguish is not reserved only for people who intentionally do evil things to rebel against God or hurt other people. Sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, people who love God and follow Jesus with all their heart, they suffer due to psychological, physiological disabilities beyond their control. Your daughter, your son that comes down with depression, it's not because she's so sinful or he's so sinful. That, oh, it's because of sin. Why this? Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to realize that we have vulnerabilities and we are placed in environments with stressors that will exacerbate these situations, and people will hurt themselves and hurt others. And sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, I want us to understand as a church that we need to provide a biblical framework for a holistic view of mental health that does not shame sufferers. We need to stop causing people to feel that what they're going through is because of sin and they need to repent and change their ways so they can be healed. Ladies and gentlemen, some of us, no prayer is gonna be able to help you in that situation. You need psychosocial, psychological evaluation. No amount of fasting is going to prevent. You need to get intervention, because God has given man the ability and the gifts and the skills to help individuals as they go through these challenges. And it says, blessed is the preacher who preaches or presents a short lecture, for he shall be invited back. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to say in conclusion tonight, just to whet your appetite, that we must view mental health issues holistically. The church has an opportunity to reach its young people. The church has an opportunity to hold and to create a comforting space where individuals can feel a part of, they can feel included, they can feel loved, so that they can share and they are not stigmatized, and it is not the shame situation where they do not feel comfortable, but everything is just covered up and it's not talked about. I want you to realize tonight that we are poised. We are on the verge of a stupendous crisis. And perhaps I might be able to do a part two of this presentation, but I want to say to you, ladies and gentlemen, the church is God's agency on earth for the salvation of souls. We are positioned to help our young people to deal with many of these mental illnesses that they are faced with. And we must act now to save a generation. May God bless you real good. And I hope the conversation will begin. God bless you.
Ms. Moderator, with your consent, I would like to ask Pastor two quick questions. Number one, if you notice or if anyone notices that someone is going through a change of behavior and you reach out to that person to talk to that person and that person refuses to communicate, no disrespect, but just stand before you and just saying, no, sir, nothing, sir. I'm all right, sir, nothing, sir. How do I go about to get around that person? The second question is that if someone is missing for maybe a week or two or three, and then suddenly turn up at your home, return home suddenly, how should the family or the church treat that individual?
Great questions, excellent question. Thank you so much for allowing me to the space. Now, because of what we're dealing with in the Jamaican context and just world over, here in North America, it might be a little bit different because individuals, they're more open, but because of the stigma over the years, people are acculturated. So you can see it's a struggle. It's very hard, it's difficult, I know, I've been there, and it's tough. They are not going to talk to you. They shut down, and they are not wanting to. You observe the signs, and you see one, two, three, four clear signs that really tell you that something is happening. You reach out, denial is going to be the first. No. Why? Because of the stigma in the back of their heads. Listen, the only way for you to survive is to say, no, nothing. I'm good, man. I'm okay, Elder. Now, what we have to do, and this is where the church is going to need to step up. We have to build caring communities. We have to build caring communities. Why am I saying this? We have to create spaces where individuals feel comfortable. There is no way that a person should be a member of the church and don't have even one close friend that they can talk to. Because we have not created that space where individuals are included and there are not relationship building activities being done in our congregations to foster this sense of cohesion, individuals will not want to talk to you. They're not going to come to me as the pastor. They're not going to come to the elders. They're going to denial. So what we need to do from this point forward is to create cohesive environment, create spaces, build relationships for the kingdom. Let me tell you, when I grew up in Jamaica, and Elder Wallace can bear me out on this, when we were growing up as pathfinders, master guides, as the case may be, you had somebody in your corner that you could talk to. Somebody can raise a hand out there. You know somebody. There was always a sister X, a brother X who was close. And so if something is going on in your life, man, there you can reach out to Elder Wallace, and you can reach out to Elder Prendy, or you can go by Sister Helen's house, or Elder Porter, and whoever the case may be, and you can just You can pour out your heart. But here is another factor that plays into this. We find that there is trust that's broken. Can I talk to the church? Mm-hmm. Many of the young people would come to us, would come to you, But you know what? There is a lack of confidentiality. Can I talk it tonight, ladies and gentlemen? You are going to tell Dick, Tom, and Harry about what's going on. So the trust is broken. And when they hear these things, because mouth, as we'd say in Jamaica, cut cross will say things. So when they hear this coming back, they say, I can't trust Elder so-and-so, or I can't trust Brother so-and-so, because they're going to talk my business. And they shut down. Number one, build meaningful relationships. Number two, create safe spaces. Make this a conversation. Open up the opportunity. Integrate it into ministry. We can no longer sideline mental health or mental illness. Put it on the sideline. It needs to be part and parcel of the ministry that the church carries out. If your pastor and your leaders aren't thinking about the mental well-being, or they weren't thinking about the mental well-being of their members 10 years ago, well, wake up. We are in a new era. And ladies and gentlemen, it's a crisis. So I believe building relationships, having that safe space, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And let me tell you, no matter what you're going through, if you have one person that you can trust, you're going to talk. You're going to talk. So that's one. 3 weeks missing. How should I address it? This is a tough one. It may be for several reasons, and I'm trying to understand the fullness of what's happening. As in this case, a person shows up after 3 weeks. What should you do? Number one, you should seek to have a conversation with the individual. And if you can't have the conversation, there has to be someone in the community or someone professionally who could have this conversation to find out what's going on. Many times individuals leave from home for different reasons. The reason they leave the space is because there is discomfort in the space. And so the discomfort might be internal, or it might be external. And so you want to ascertain what's going on. What are the underlying factors? You want to understand what's the, they come with the presenting problem. The presenting problem to you really is, went away, 3 weeks, show up. That's what you see. But what is the real problem? The presenting problem is never normally the problem. There is something else. Maybe there's a broken relationship. Maybe there's mistrust going on. Maybe there is abuse taking place where this individual might be abusing drugs, as the case may be. Maybe they are into sexual relationships and all these kinds of, there can be a plethora of issues. So we have to understand first and foremost what's happening in that context. We have to also reach out and seek help, professional help, get help for the individual. And lovingly, you know, sometimes it's not what you say, but how you say it, ladies and gentlemen. And my mother used to say, you can get, more bees with honey than with vinegar, you know, something, you know, be nice. Honest commendation, you know, let them settle in the space and find the most inopportune time to bring up a conversation regarding the issue, and start in a wise and careful way of finding out, and also just being a friend. Just being a friend to the individual. Befriend them. And it might be your child, your son, your daughter. It might be a family member. You've got to get, your aim is to get into the psyche. You have to get into their heart. And the only way you're going to get into their heart is if they trust you, they love you, they respect you, and they are willing to divulge. Then they are willing to divulge this to you. I hope that's kind of preliminary answer to the question. Barring that, ladies and gentlemen, it's going to be difficult, and I'll have to look at the full gamut of the case as to what's happening. Any other questions? Any other questions out there?
Yes, so following up on the returning of the person, should the parents or relatives or members of the church sort of shun that individual and criticize and condemn, or should the parents yell at that individual and say, where have you been, you disgrace me? How should parents, or how should the young people, or how should other members or elders, leaders of the church accept her, him or her?
Love wins. Love wins every time. Non-judgmental attitude. The church is a hospital for sinners, ladies and gentlemen. And I want you to understand that there are broken people that really come to our churches, and we should not shun them, no matter what they're going through, ladies and gentlemen. We must open the arms of love wide. The church must be welcoming and embracing. I want you to realize that we need to stop, ladies and gentlemen, we need to stop pushing people away. Love covers a multitude of sins. And I want you to realize tonight that Jesus's method is still the same today. What did Jesus do to outcasts and winebibbers and drunks? Look at wicked Judas, who was among them, and you know how he responded to him lovingly. This should be or habit or pattern as we deal with the erring, as we deal with those who are struggling. You don't know what they're going through. And until you know, you will not be able to rightly respond. And but for the grace of God, there go I, there go you. You know, ladies and gentlemen, if night should turn today, a lot of people would run away, says somebody. You know why? Because many of us, we are hanging by a thread. It is only the mercies of God that's keeping us. And I want you to understand tonight that we must embrace people. We must love. We must love the sinner, yet we hate the sin. We know these are fundamental principles that we have always believed in. But as we are dealing with mental health issues, especially when you push people away, you might push them over the brink. And I've seen instances where individuals have committed suicide because they found out that they were pregnant, the church did not accept it, and so no one accepted them. Their parents were leaders in the church, and the next thing was to take their life. So, ladies and gentlemen, we need to ensure that we are building relationships and the church is being relevant. The church is really scratching where it itch, and we are really dealing with the subject matter at hand. Thank you so much. Any other questions tonight as I prepare to close? My, the time just flew by, I tell you. But I am thankful for the opportunity to share. Thankful for the opportunity to share. Any other comments, any other questions at this time? I will turn over to your moderator. It's so good to see you all again at Bath, and my love and blessings, and thank you, Dahlia, for just being in my neck. I love Dahlia and Helen. They're wonderful people. And I thank God for all of you. Great seeing you. Let us keep one another in prayer. At this time, I think if I'm looking at your schedule that I got, Sister Prendergast is just an amazing person. She's so organized, and I praise God for her. She kept in touch. Everything was organized, and that's what I'm talking about. That's the kind of member I want in my church. Amen. Amen. Shall we pray at this time? Is it the appropriate time, Madam Moderator, for prayer?
Go ahead and pray, Pastor.
Okay, sure. Let us pray. Almighty God and our everlasting Father, we thank you this blessed evening for Jesus. We thank you, O God, that we have a mighty intercessor who reigns in the sanctuary above, a Jesus who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities, for he was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. A Jesus who understands the troubles that we are going through. A Jesus who has been down the pathway of mental anguish. where he felt like giving up. Father, he declared in the garden, if it be, let this cup be taken from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Tonight we come to this Jesus, believing that he understands our struggles. And I come tonight in the name of Jesus, lifting up this praying community. I pray that you'd keep the Bath community mentally strong. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would surround them with an atmosphere of peace. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would beat back the forces of darkness. I ask you, mighty God, even now that you would allow your people to realize that we are positioned strategically to meet the mental health issues that our people are faced with in this crisis. The church is still the answer. The truth and the life is still the answer to the problems of this world. Tonight, I pray for someone who is at the point of breaking. Tonight, I pray that you would lift such a one up and you would send help. You will send reinforcement from the portals of glory. Tonight, I pray that you would break down the strongholds of the enemy. Tonight, I pray that you would cripple and paralyze every plan of Satan. In the name of Jesus, we pray for restoration. In the name of Jesus, we pray for strength. In the name of Jesus, we decree tonight that the stigma is broken. And oh God, we will seek to be your brother's keeper, and we would seek to bear one another's burden, so fulfilling the law of love. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would bless this family life experience at Bath. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would make it a blessing. I pray for every young person on this conference tonight. I pray that they would be anchored in you. They'll be so strong in mind. They will have the mind of Jesus. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Let the power of Almighty God be upon you. I pray for clarity of mind and thought. I rebuke every plan of the adversary for your young people tonight. I pray that Jesus Christ will be first and best in their lives, that freedom will be experienced, that joy will be experienced, and that deliverance will come. Lord, give us the willingness to trust in you. For every family that's struggling tonight, bring comfort. For every person that seemed to be walking alone in the dark, bring your presence and your peace. May the conversation start in this congregation, and may proper mental health be integrated into this congregation for your glory and for your honor, so that when you come, you will be able to call home your children and will say, come ye blessed of my Father, you who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. And we will spend eternity with you. Hear this, our prayer tonight, in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Amen and amen. May God bless you all. Thank you for sharing tonight.
Amen, amen, Pastor.
Hi, sorry, I really wanted to ask a question, but I know at this point in time it's not possible. But can you just allow me? Because what I'm thinking about is that this is, I had commented in the chat, but this is very, very important. So I want to find out from Pastor Hay if there are opportunities to have like screeners, because like you'd have mentioned in the presentation, many of our churches are suffering. So are there screeners? Is there the possibility where we can have what you call like a first line responders training? So like, you know, have an individual in the church who is able to manipulate such a screener, so at least they can say, okay, of course, in confidentiality, that, okay, here's someone who is and can do further referral. But I think that's where we need to go in terms of having at least one individual in each of our churches trained in mental health. So certainly not to the point of becoming a psychologist, because that's going to take some time, but to, as I mentioned before, first line of response.
Great, you're going where I was going in my presentation. And one of the things that Sister Helling will bear out is that when I pastored at Wakefield, we were able to have mental health first aid training, where she's trained as a responder. And she knows the basic signs, what to look for, what to respond to. And so when you have a congregation that's trained, they are able to better respond to what's happening. So we want to equip our members. And yes, there is training available. Yes, you can have individuals in the congregation who can be frontline or first line persons who will be able to assess. You're not a psychologist, you're not a therapist, but you're able to pick up certain things and you're able to move it along to help the person to get help. If you understand me. So the other thing too, you need to tap into a part of the presentation that I spoke about. The church needs to create a ministry, not really create a ministry. It should be a part of ministry. This is ministry because we need to integrate. That's the word I'm looking for. We need to integrate into our church life, mental health training, mental wellness. It needs to become a part. The family life department of the church needs to be the driver. And in that bus, if you please, that you're driving, one of the things or one of the aspects would be mental health training how to deal with mental illness and, you know, simple things that you can do. And yes, mental health first aid. There is such a training that can be done. Individuals can become trained and they can have the basic skills as to how to pick up and how to kind of zero in when you see and sense a problem and be able to get help for the individual. Great question. That was where I was going. The church should try to implement something like that, get professionals to come in to train. Tap into your social workers, tap into your counselors, tap into your professionals, because most pastors, the research shows 80 to 90% of pastors have no training whatsoever in mental health. Absolutely no training. And most times you go to them, all they say, okay, sister, let's sit down and pray. And pray about it, sister, pray about it in the name of Jesus. And listen, prayer is powerful, don't get me wrong. But there are some things that needs intervention and it needs professional intervention so that healing and help can be had. Great question, my sister.
Thank you so much.
I think this is the beginning of a great conversation. God bless.
Thank you, Pastor Hay, for making yourself available to be the medium that the Lord would have used this evening to present this powerful, or bring to us this powerful presentation. One that has been very enlightening, very motivational. We are most appreciative of all that you have done this evening. And it is our prayer that your ministry will grow from strength to strength. That as you press on in what you do, as you follow your calling, you will continue to impact lives as the Lord ordained. Family of God, Bath and otherwise, we were just empowered in a marvelous way to apply to our lives, starting first the information that was given, and then use this same information to be of help to those within our household, within our church, within our wider community. I know for sure that we have been blessed. And yes, the host of heaven rejoices with us for this information that we have received this evening. I leave with you a quick reminder that the program continues during this week. On Tuesday evening, we will be looking at social and intellectual wellness. And on Wednesday evening, we'll be looking at spiritual wellness. Be sure, by the grace of God, that once you're alive and breathing, you will not miss any of these presentations. Yes, we are there. This ministry continues on YouTube, on Instagram, and on Facebook. So feel free to find this ministry there and to continue receiving the blessings from God. I leave with you a thought from Councils on Health under the topic, The Outlook. And it says, to every worker, and worker here speaks to you and I who would have received this information tonight. Every worker, I would say, go forth in humble faith, and the Lord will go with you. But watch unto prayer. This is the science of your labor. The power is of God. Work in dependence upon Him, remembering that you are laborers together with Him. He is your helper. Your strength is from Him. He will be your wisdom, your righteousness, your sanctification, and your redemption. Thank you again, Pastor Hay. Have a good night to you and your family and to everyone else. Thank you for being here with us tonight. Have a wonderful rest. Have a wonderful rest of your night. And as we go, our engineer will take us out with our family song, I'm so part family of God. Have a wonderful night, everyone, and may God bless us.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join with Jesus as we travel in God. For I'm part of the family. Now you'll notice we say brother and sister round here. It's because we're a family. These folks are so near. When one has a heartache, we all share the tears and rejoice in each victory in this family so deep. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family, the family of God. From the door of an orphanage to the house of the King, no longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags unto riches, from the weak to the strong, I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God I belong. Oh, I'm so glad.
travel this side, for I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel.